Okay, please going on.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Today I will present the paper Contouring Adversarial Images Using Input Transformation. This paper is from Facebook AI research team. So since I have a series of presentation on adversarial attacks, so I guess you are already familiar with the background here. Researchers have found that nearly all classifiers are vulnerable to adversarial attack. And the existing defense strategies can be divided into two big categories. The first one is model specific. The second one is model agnostic. For a model specific approach, the focus is to make the model more robust. However, the model needs to be retrained or specifically trained using some techniques. So we incur additional training costs. Moreover, since the defendant need to generate adversarial examples themselves, so they have to make assumptions on what kinds of attack the adversarial use. So this decreases the performance of model-specific strategy. On the other hand, model-agnostic strategy has gradually attracted the attention of researchers. The idea is to remove perturbation from inputs, so it is a more straightforward way, and it puts no assumption on the type of adversarial attack or the type of model used. So thus, we introduce the scope of this paper. So this paper is trying to find an effective transformation function to remove noises from inputs. The challenge for model agnostic approach is that usually adversarial attacks is perturbed on the full image, so the noises are distributed everywhere. We need to have a very strong denoising transformation to sufficiently remove noises. This work suggests to use the following transformations as the denoising function: image cropping, bit depth reduction, GPEG compression, total variance minimization, and image quoting. This transformation, except for bit depth reduction and GPEG compression, are not original design for adversarial defense. So the author's contribution is to apply and evaluate them in adversarial defense scenario.
So in this work, it will look into all those five adversary or all those transformation approach, right? And then they specifically designed for, and they specifically invented for invented the bit depth reductions and the GPE compression.
No. These two types has been used in other literature.
Okay,
so as adversarial defense. So
let me say they have already proposed. Okay, all those approach, the image cropping and rescaling. So it seems it's still a very general approach, right?
Yeah.
So there's still some that the all of them are existing approach. And the existing literature have seen that the most effective one are bit depth reductions and the JPEG compression.
No, only these two are used in adversarial defense. For other transformation, they are not used.
They haven't been investigated.
As a defense strategy. Yeah.
Okay, they haven't been investigated. So this approach proposed their own transformation?
No.
Okay, so it's more like a evaluation of the not only for existing approach, but also they select a few the other potential transformation to see how is their effect to denoise the image. Okay, so would you please specify more about the image quilting?
So what is
image quilting?
Did I also introduce the first four transformation?
Okay, you can introduce for also. Maybe I suggest the students here to raise more questions.
So the first transformation is image cropping and rescaling. So it's often used in data augmentation. So here the intuition is that since the attack is against the full image, but if the image is cropped into small patches, then each patch may still be predicted as its initial label. So in this work, for each image, they are going to randomly sample 30 crops of size 90 by 90, and then feed each of the crop and get all the predictions and average over all the crops. So that, but that really depends on whether the model works well in predicting partial image.
Yeah, so it still have some challenges for training, right? So originally they training the whole images, but now they train only partial images. But the attacker still, it is still possible for the attacker because the perturbation has been applied. So even
yes.
if we crop the partial images, the perturbation still remained on these partial crops.
Yes.
And the so what does the attacker, how this approach can defend the adversary attack? Because the perturbation is still there. So it's more like a, if the transformation we would like to discuss is that when, so in the best case, the attacker apply a lot of perturbations. If we can undo all those perturbations, then that would be a perfect approach, right?
Yeah, so this transformation does not undo, but it changes the spatial relation for the perturbation because it applies crops.
Yeah, but so that means you have a model. We suppose you have models to predict on these partial images. So if we have a model, so the attacker can still attack those partial images, right?
Yes, the attacker can still attack. So it's not a very good approach.
Okay.
Oh, the second transformation is speed depth reduction or GPEJ decompression. Their idea are the same, so I put them together. Because the perturbations are usually small, and if we can reduce the image bit depth to be 3 bits, so originally it is 8 bits, then a small change in 8-bit image makes no difference when representing as a 3-bit image. So the image becomes insensitive to small changes. But on the other hand, we have potential loss of precision because now we reduce the number of bits to represent an image.
So it's still like a way, is that a way of more like the adversary training? So I'm not sure. So I still somehow lose some of your points here. So you're going to reduce the bit depth to 3 bits. So what? How do you define the bit depth?
Because the image is from 0 to 255.
Yes.
So the 8-bit image. We can also.
What? Okay. I see. So
yeah.
So it's zero one pixel. Yes.
One pixel is from 0 to 255.
Yeah.
So that means we divide the space into 256 possibilities. But we can also divide the space into 8 possibilities. So if 255 becomes 254, then in terms of the 3-bit image, they are the same.
So this is your original have 126
possibilities.
126 possibilities. You're going to divide them into
eight.
So you give them about 8 portion, right?
Eight
range.
Hmm.
So why do you call it 3 bits?
3 bits means 2 to the power of 3 is 8, right? So originally it's 2 to the power of 8.
So here, suppose is this range, this series, if it is divided by 8, so it will be 0 to 32, right? So the first range is 0 to 31, and then 62 to 63, right? So this range. So that means once, so giving the images, so it will change this range into one simple pixel.
Yeah.
So this one is 2. So then based on this model, it's going to fix into the model, right?
Mm.
That is the point. So yeah, so it will lose the color. So the training model only takes, so the training model only takes the transformer. So the training model, it just works on the training model is working on the transformed image.
As for the training model, it's trained on clean image, but it can also be trained on transform image.
No, okay. I think, so let's see. So if we train it, they have two ways. The first way is train, this is your clean image is this on 256, right? And the clean images is on, suppose it's 8 bits, change 8 bits. So it will have, so each image will becomes, so there's a calculation correct? Yeah, this calculation correct. So given a, so suppose, so 256 is more like a pixel color, right? So originally they have the 200, over 200 colors, but now it has only 8 colors, right? So the model is, so let's say this is another, this is 2. I use a different color. This is 1 and this is 2. So if they, whether they trend, I think these two approaches are very different for the defense mechanism.
Yes, so they evaluate both. The first one is training on clean image only and apply transformation during test time. The second one is apply transformation during training and both training and testing.
But when you train on the clean images and now the images comes to the transformed images, then the distribution of images change, right?
Yeah.
So the model accuracy will be influenced, right? So you can see there's a portion of the images. This portion of clean images are feeding to the model. But however, you giving a models, you do the transformations. Let's say it's S prime and feeding to model again. And S prime is conformed to a very different distribution of the original images. So in this case, will the model accuracy be influenced?
So it be influenced on clean images.
Just more like a, so just more like a, let's take another extreme case for transformation. So giving a original images of scenery, of sceneries. So we can transform the scenery into an impression, impression scenery. So like a pixel on Picasso, the Picasso style, it will change into a very, an artistic styles. Then you have this more like S prime, right? Then you feed this S prime to the original models. The original model is a trend for analyzing or processing the normal scenery. But now you have transformed into an artistic scenery. Then you feed it into the models. So we never know whether the model can still perform the same. Because the S prime does not conform to the original distribution. So
yes.
this is my first question. This is my questions or for the first approach. And another question for the second approach is that if we adopt this approach, like we have trained models with 8 bits, so the original 256 images have been compressed into eight colors. So suppose that the attacker can still perturbate on this 8-bit, right? So the more like let's change another colors. So there's another portion of change that, let's say it's a D prime, and this is D. And we can still, attacker still can still apply the perturbations on D prime, right?
D prime is a transformed
image. So the attacker can still apply perturbations or attack based on D prime. So attacker can do the transformation itself and then do the perturbation on the transformed images. So
yes.
It's still supposed to compromise the model. So in summary, both approaches still have reviews on vulnerability for being attacked. Am I correct?
Yeah, these two approaches are the most simple, are too simple to be.
Yeah,
and as for your first question, I think the author also have discussed this point. So during training, they also add the transformation inside data augmentation.
So that model is being generalized.
Yeah.
So the only way so that we can defend them is that the attacker does not know has already trained them. So if the attacker does not have the knowledge of such a transformation, then this approach is more like a
gray box.
More like masking. Right? Masking. It's more like masking. It's going to mask. Suppose the color is original is 260. So more like it's in these ways. But now you are looking into 8 grams. So you're still more like masking. So you remove the gradients of the images. So we do not, in this case, just what we discussed with Zhang Chen. In this case, we do not apply masking on the layer, on the neural network layer. We apply masking on the image. So that is the rationale, right? That becomes the rationale. Okay. That makes sense. Okay, please go on.
The next one is total variance minimization. Because the adversarial perturbations are directly at noises onto some pixels, so the image becomes non-smooth locally. But if we can reconstruct a smooth image from some pixel, then we can eliminate the effect of perturbation. So first we draw some random variable x.
How do you know it is smooth or not?
We will do some optimization.
And how do you define smooth? How do you define being smooth?
The difference between pixel value is large between adjacent rows or adjacent columns. So from human eyes, you cannot see it is smooth or not. But if you look at the value, you will see there's a jump.
So what I understand is that this is original images. So suppose this is space. And this is supposed to be colors. But that the perturbation is more like this one, right? It's more like this one.
Oh.
Right. So that makes sense. But we never know. But my point is that we never know if the attacker can still construct a smooth perturbation like this. Right? The attacker, this is attacker. And A, this attacker and this is attacker two, and this one, the original one, is a normal. So attacker may still provide a smooth when we construct the. Of course, it will improve, it will increase the difficulty or cause the challenges when generating the virtual inputs. But here I don't know whether it is possible that we make the image smooth, make the sample smooth, while it's still an adversary sample. It's still an open question for me. Okay, please go on. Or do you have any answers for that?
No. Okay. So first we draw some random variable x. So xijk, that means we draw a random variable for each pixel location ijk, follows Bernoulli distribution of p. Then we maintain a pixel when x is equal to 1, and we drop the pixel when x is equal to 0. So p, 1 minus p is the pixel dropout rate. And then we construct new image z by solving this optimization equation. The first term, this sign means.
Sorry, I forgot what is z is.
Z is the new image after transformation, and x is the original image. This x can be clay image or adversarial image.
X, the you mean the small x, right?
Yes, a small x.
Okay.
So the first term, the sign denotes the element-wise multiplication. When x is equal to 1, so when the random variable is 1, then we keep the pixel. if x is 0, we minimize the L2 norm of z minus x. So it's just trying to construct an image z that is similar to x. The second term is a hyperparameter times the total variance of z. So this is the detailed formula for total variance. We can see that this term is the between row variance, and this term is the between column variance. So this total variance controls the smoothness for adjacent row and column.
Okay, so basically it will using the distribution to make sure giving an image, so whatever it is the original image, whatever it is, the velocity or a normals, we're still trying to smooth the neighbors, right? Smooth the images between the neighbors.
To summarize, total variance minimization is trying to construct image Z that is similar to image X, while it's also being sampled in terms of total variation. The last one is image quartering. Because the adversarial changes the texture of original image, that makes the model to misrecognize. But if we can reconstruct image from some known clean texture, then we can defend against adversarial attacks. So image quartering is a technique that synthesizes image by piecing together small patches that are taken from a database of patches. So the effect is that it transfers the texture of original image to the patches texture, to our desired texture. For example, we can reconstruct human face from rice texture.
Would you please specify more about these images? So the idea is that so the input is these two images, right?
The input is an image and a patch we select. Then we divide the image into small grids. Then for each grid, we are going to reconstruct it from the patch. So now it becomes like this.
But the model still need to recognize the quilting results. So does the attacker have the knowledge of this quilting?
No.
So what's the difference between those quilting? So the from the rationale part, what's the difference between quilting and the compression? They still when they give images, they still do the transformation, right? So just apply different transformation. For now, we're just using the quilting to change what it looks. And if you're using compression, also still change what it looks. So from my point of view, those quiltings introduce more complexity, but I haven't seen the cause and effect. I haven't seen the causality. But for the compressions, the causality is very clear because it is just more like applying the masking.
So the causality is that we adopt the idea from image quilting. Then we build a patch database by collecting some clean examples, patches. Then given a test image X, we are going to reconstruct Z from the one of its closest neighbor in the patch database. So the resulting image only consists of pixels that are clean, that are not modified by adversary.
That's it. Build a patch database by collecting
patches from clean examples.
So this patch are from clean examples, right?
Yes.
And giving an image constructs Z is close to neighbors in the patch. So it's more like Z is changed by X and the one of his neighbor, N, right? But Z prime, but this Z, I still didn't see the much causality. I still didn't see much causality here. So I know
so,
that
so the z just come from n because we just choose a neighbor from patch database. So every pixel of z has actually no relationship with x, but just come from n.
Just come from it constructed z from
constructed from patch. Construct from patch only, and this X is only used to select which patch from database.
So then this word has a introducing ambiguities. So Z is not reconstructed. Z is selected from the database.
Yes, but you have to select multiple of them.
Then,
because I divide the image into grid, then for each grid, you select one patch. Then you combine all of them into Z. So I call it reconstruct. Or you can call it construct, whatever.
So may I ask what this patch database look like?
Just from clean examples, I don't know what it looks like. So you have to collect some clean examples and construct the patch database.
So these clean examples are training are somehow similar to the training examples?
Yes. Should be similar to training examples.
But after transformation, it still should have keep the same semantics.
Yeah. It will keep, like, you see the rice example.
Does the patch, but for the examples which you have shown, in previous example, the patch is the rice image.
Yes.
The patch is the rice image. So that means when we train the models, we are train images with rice. Image.
Actually, not with rice image. It's just with all the patches from clean examples. Like if you use Cypher 10, then there will be some car, cats, dogs, etc.
I'm not sure by this approach the word trans, the semantics of the images can still be preserved.
Oh yes, it seems that it will be preserved.
It seems to preserve. For example, if I choosing for Cypher 10 images, if I choose the human face, and how will be this human face be still looks like?
For Cypher 10, it doesn't have human face.
Yes, and what if I fit into a human face into it? It largely depends on your database. So
yeah.
The both given images, you cannot choose appropriate. And also the other question is, how do you define the closest neighbors? Based on their two norm of the image patch? Or we still need to leverage a model to, like a Simons model, to choose the closest neighbors?
No, I don't think they use deep learning model, but I'm not sure for the details how they choose the neighbor.
I think this approach it just feels a little bit risky. But I'm more comfortable with the compression.
But that one is too simple. And if the attacker knows that you use compression, then it can just attack.
We still can hear using different approach like random, using non-deterministic algorithm. Suppose we have different way of compressions. We can compress it based on 2 bits, 16 bits, or 2 bits. So based on this approach, we can make the model more complicated.
If you reduce the bits too much, then.
Of course, if the attackers know the idea of the patch, it is still possible for them to do the perturbation, right? It just need to make sure, after perturbation, the result of the patch model can still influence the model prediction. It's still possible. So more like the transformation is more like a defense technique.
But for this quartering, it actually introduced some randomness inside. So this closest neighbor is selected from maybe k neighbors from the patch database, so the attacker cannot exactly simulate.
That means when choosing the neighbors, there involves some determinism. Non-determinism.
Yeah. And in fact, the author actually suggests this tool over the others because it has some randomness inside. So it becomes non-differentiable. The attacker cannot propagate the gradients back to the image.
Okay, please go on. Mm.
So the overall defense strategy is that, so during testing time, we apply the transformation on image and then feed into the model. During training time, we train with clean images, but yes, like the question you raised, so this has some problem. So I will discuss this later. And to evaluate how strong those five transformations as defense, the paper evaluates against four types of adversarial attack. If you are unfamiliar, you can just review this YouTube link. The research question one is how effective it is to gridbox attack. Gridbox attack means we have access to model's architecture as well as the model's parameter, but we are unaware of the defense strategy that is being used. And the dotted line represent if no defense is applied, how the testing performance is changing. So you can see if no defense, the accuracy drops significantly and finally becomes zero. And all the five transformations can improve somehow, where the crop example is the best, but that looks very strange because this crop and resize is so simple. That is only because during training, this crop and resize inside data augmentation, but other transformations are not applied. So the model works very well on cropped image. Thus, it is unfair to compare this crop and resize with other defenses.
Sorry, will you please elaborate more about this unfairness?
It's just the question you ask. Because the model have seen this cropped image, so it works very well on cropped image, but the model have not learned the other kinds of transformation. So if other transformations are applied during testing time, then the model cannot be generalized to that kind of distribution.
And how this model can have ever seen it? Because you can see the model never see the perturbated version. So given images, it have several crops, supposedly it kept cropping to three images.
Because it's inside data augmentation during training.
No, my point is, my point is that this is images, right? Images will have a perturbation version. This I prime. I prime has never seen it. So that's because I prime one, I prime two, and I prime three, right? We feed it into images. And the model may have seen I1, I2, and I3. But they have never seen I prime one, I prime, I one prime, I two prime, I three prime. They have never seen it. And how this will be effective?
Just effective. It's just, yeah.
Okay. We still have some questions. But right, I suppose that this is a least defensive approach because these images. So this is actually cannot be considered as a transformation because the perturbation there has still, the point is that if the attackers, or one of the idea is that attacker has never know, the attacker never know this eye will be, attacker has never, will never know on this I prime will be decomposed into one. So in this case, the attacker will never know all the positions or the scale has been changed. Okay, so in this case, attacker is more like doing some random perturbation, right? More like doing some random perturbation instead of gradient-based.
It's still gradient based, it just is only use the model part. It does not know that you have a transformation module. So
yeah.
you only compute
yeah,
gradient with respect to model.
But my point
is
that the model may have to learn. So is that the same model? So the model learns the original images, both are, so the model is handling both the eye and the original images and the cropped image, right? So the original images is I, and here is I prime, right? It's I1. So because it's one cropped. So the model, when we train the model, we feed both I and I1 or II into the model to let him predict.
Yes.
As a classification model. Okay, but when the attacker is going to attack. Okay. So maybe in this case, after we slightly change the images, and the attacker is more like doing the random perturbation. Because the original attack maybe attack these two parts. And after you crop, so this image, this eye is more like this perturbation is now moved into here. Right?
Uh-huh.
So this becomes the perturbation. This is a sample prime. And then after we do the rescale, it will move into S. So this S will actually be more like a random perturbation instead of the targeted perturbation.
Oh, okay. So to make a fair comparison, during training, they just add all the transformations as data augmentation and the input image. And they are going to ask the question again. And now we can see that a crop example, total wise minimization and image quality are effective.
TV, what is TV?
Total variance.
Total variance. Okay, it becomes smoothing. But the compression does not work well, right?
Yes.
Why it does not work well? How do they implement these ones? It's not supposed to be because all the gradients has been masked. So I suppose that if we're using the masking, the idea it's supposed not be moved anymore. Right?
Maybe when you compress the number of bits, then that also degrades the performance as well.
Okay, let's go. So I just feel that the results is feel a little bit counterintuitive. You can please go on.
Then we are launching black box attack. Black box means we are transferring adversarial examples generated from a separately trained model. So you can see that image quality and total variance minimization are the most effective ones.
So this black box is a retrainer model. Generated from So the deep fool is still a very effective attack, right? Do we have a code of a deep fool? Okay, maybe we can integrate it into this framework. Is Zhang Chen here? Zhang Chen leaves. Okay, so maybe we can talk this. So Zhang Chen, we will ask Zhang Chen to still work on the deep fool. Is deep fool is still our framework, okay?
Research question four is that since we already know that single transformation works well, but how effective if we ensemble multiple transformation? That means we average the we average the prediction result for multiple transformations. We can say that the best black box defense achieves an accuracy of about 71% against all four attacks. So the best one is here. If no attack, it's only 75. Oh, this is ResNet 50, ResNet 101, DenseNet, and Inception V4.
So this is accuracy, right? This is an accuracy.
This is accuracy.
So what is original accuracy? Does this defense
this
approach?
This is original accuracy, no attack, right? No attack.
No, I mean, so this is defense technique. Masking the accuracy without applying any defense accuracy, the accuracy without applying any defense.
Without.
Yet, yes.
So not showing in this table.
Yeah, we're going to see the cost, which brought by the defense mechanism, introduced by transformation. So if I'm the one, I will first just see that what is the accuracy drop, or what are the costs we're going to, what we need to pay for applying transformation. Then the second question is going to be whether they can successfully defense in a lot of attacks. What's going on?
The last question is how effective it is compared to model-specific defense. So here, it compares with one baseline ensemble training approach. This I have presented before. Apparently, model-agnostic defense is more robust.
Will you please recap a little bit about the example, the idea of the example approach? It's more like a...
You example many adversarial examples generated from multiple models and use that various adversarial example to retrain your network to make it more robust.
So it means that we have at least three models?
Yes.
So giving a model, we have three models to do the prediction.
To generate the adversarial example, then you retrain.
Okay.
Hmm.
So more like a adversary sample. Adversary training?
Yeah, adversarial training.
Okay.
So in fact, the idea of model agnostic defense is to design a transformation function J. And then if the classifier is H, our defense wants to make HJX prime equal to HJX. Ideally, to make the defense effective, this J should satisfy, first one is non-differentiable. So the attacker has no way to compute gradients back to X. And second one is involves some randomization. So even if the attacker knows the defense strategy, he cannot simulate what exactly happens. So these two methods are recommended by the author. Because total variation randomly selects some pixels to drop and some pixels to keep, while image cluttering random selects a patch from clean database. It makes J to be randomized and a non-differentiable function. Okay.
Yeah, I'm still thinking transformation is one way to go. Indeed, it's one way to go. But I just feel that the masking, the gradient masking approach, or the image compression approach, they can definitely reduce. I'm just very, very curious about why the image compressions or the gradient masking will not work in the experiment, because all the gradients has gone. So all the gradients has gone, but yeah, the transformation, maybe what we got is just an adversary version. So somehow if we trend into, I don't know. Maybe that's what we can try in our own. The first is that we are going to do something. Maybe we can implement our own to see the effects. So this part, maybe we can delegate to Zhangchen to have a try. Because Ruofan and Qingzhou, we have a paper to submit in the coming 1 week, coming less than 2 weeks. So in this case, we will ask Zhangchen to have a check of this transformation-based approach. Okay, good work, Ruofan. So next one, how about Xiangling?
Yeah, so the paper I'm going to present today is called Exploring Connection Between Active Learning and Model Extraction. So it is a very new paper just published on August 2020. It is published in Usenet, which is one of the top conferences in security area. And the author is a PhD candidate from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. So here comes the background. So in the past, people have their own training data at local and their own machine, and then they can train their model locally and for their own purpose. But the training data is become larger, and also the training process requires more tools and resources. So people began to transfer their training data in the cloud and use the tool and resources in the cloud to help them train the model. So after they got the model, they can access to their model using the query interface. And furthermore, they can actually make their model public and provide this query interface to other users and charge them a price for every query other users made. But here comes a problem. So the owner of the model may want to keep their own model secret for reasons like sensitive training data or commercial value of their own model. So this tension between model confidentiality and public access motivates this research of model extraction attack. So in such attack, an adversary with black box access but no prior knowledge of a machine learning model's parameters or training data aims to duplicate the function, the functionality of the model, which means they want to steal the model for other purpose. So the contribution of this paper, it contains three parts. The first part is that they formalize model extraction as an active learning problem. And the second one is that they implement attack without auxiliary information like confidence values. And at last, they also propose some defense strategies. And then they also do some experiment to prove some of the defense strategy works. So first we should have a look at what is passive learning and active learning. So in a passive setting, a framework called PAC learning framework is predominantly used. So PAC means probably approximately correct. So in this setting, we assume there is an underlying distribution D on data X times Y that describes the data. And the learner have no direct knowledge of this distribution D, but they can have access to a set of training data drawn from D. Here, for example, in object recognition, X can be the space of all images, and Y can be a set of objects that we wish to detect in these images. So here we refer to a pair XY as a data point or labeled instance. And finally, we have a hypothesis class function, hypothesis class F, and that is known in advance. So the learner's goal is to find a function F in this hypothesis class that is a net that is equivalent or near equivalent to the previous to the function we wanted to learn. And to measure how close our learned function F and the targeted function F, we can use loss function like 0, 1 loss, which is for discrete labels. So if the predict label for X is equal to the true label Y, then the loss would be 0, otherwise it would be 1. And also if the label is a continuous value, then we can use the square loss. So I think passive learning is just like the training process for some neural network.
Yeah, I'm listening. So you are introducing the normal. We do is passive learning.
And then. So here is a formal definition of passive learning. And then we should take a look at active learning. So in a passive learning, we need to require a larger number of data points. But however, for active learning, the learning algorithm is allowed to select a subset of unlabeled instances and query for their labels from an annotators like human or some automate programs and use it to construct or update a model. So we have two active learning scenario. One is called PSCN, one is called query synthesis. The difference between PAC active learning and query synthesis is that PAC active learning can have access to a subset of data points from actual distribution. However, for query synthesis active learning, the learner have no knowledge of the data points, so they have to generate it from uniform distribution.
Here the questions here. For a real scenario, suppose there's an image classifier, and there always be a PAC learning, right? Because the images or function of the face recognition, the people will always have to know what a human face looks like, or suppose in our Singtel application, so we will have a screenshot and a feed into a model, and the model will predict whether it is a efficient page or not. So whatever it is, so I assume that in a lot of scenarios, or as far as I can imagine, it seems that we always have a PAC active learning. So can you raise the example of what is the curious synthesis? So in what scenarios will the attacker not aware of how the input looks like?
We will have a simple example later.
Or can you just briefly mention it, or we can also leave it later?
I cannot think of an example, but sometimes you just don't know.
But anyway, so suppose attacker, if they want to use the system must provide something to tell the user how to use it, right?
Yeah.
So just from the user menu, at least the attacker will know some.
I think the difference lies in, we will have a simple example later than I.
Okay, I'll just leave the question. Okay, we'll leave this question open and then please go on.
So the PAC active learning also have two scenarios. One is called stream-based sampling, which means the instances are sampled once at a time and the learner decides whether to query for the label or not on a stream basis. However, for the pool-based sampling, all the data points are in a static pool and the learner chooses specific instance in the pool and query for their labels.
So the stream and the pool is more like the range, the scope of the samples, right? It's more because attacker will always, or the learner will always have the capability of curing for a label, curing for the label of a sample. And the difference is that the stream base is that you're going to sample on the runtime, just like same sample on the runtimes. And there's a pool basis that are always selected from the pool. So the difference is just from the scope, right? Yes, I think I'm right. So so the difference is not on how learner to make a query. The difference is that the scenarios and and the pool base is supposed to be, the pool is super large. And we're going to select the samples in a smart way.
The author also provides some real world scenario, like for the stream based sampling. It's for example, the stream of data is collected by a sensor, but the labeling requires an expert.
Okay, please go on.
So this is a simple example of this active learning. So this is a half space classification in one dimension. So a function is described by W, which is the green line. And the data points lies on the real line and their labels are a sequence of -1 followed by a sequence of 1. So the goal is to discover a point W where the change from -1 to 1 happens. So the active learning, the learner can just perform a binary research. And for example, at first he can query for the X1 and he can know that the label is 1. And then he queries for X2 and he gets the label of -1. And then any value that is larger than X1 or that is less than X2, the learner can decide not to query for their label because that's useless. And finally,
it assumes that F is monotonic, right? So it assumes F is monotonic. But it's not monotonic. So it's arranged. So what does this mean?
So it just means the label is,
so it's more like
the W times X, and the label is the sign of W times X. So this is a half space classification, which is linear SVM. So the W is the boundary.
So the Wx, what's the difference between fx and Wx? W is a function. W is a parameter or function.
It's a because this is in dimension. This is one dimension. So W would be a values. If it is in high dimension, then W is a high dimension vector.
Should this be zero?
Wx.
So I cannot read it.
Yeah.
I cannot read this. So the W.
This is like the linear SVM. So W, if W times X is less than, less than zero, then the label would be minus one. So the function would be the sine of W times X.
So it's W times X. So it's more like W is from your formula, the W is more like a function. But W is not a function, right? W is just a constant. W
so
is just a
constant. It's a weight vector.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just a weight vector.
Yeah.
It's not a, okay, so this one is really confusing here.
Oh, so right. Then you can just ignore it. But
so it's more like a W plus X is smaller than.
If it is greater than zero, then yeah. So that's how, this is a simple example how the learner decides whether to query the label or not.
And the learner can query it just because it knows fx is a monotonic function. So it can make such a query. Right?
Yeah.
Suppose the function is more like this one. Then the learner can make the learner more difficult to do the query.
That would be in other scenarios. So here the scenario is just a linear linear classification.
Okay, please.
And then the query synthesis is active learning. So the input is generated by the learner from a uniform distribution. And the difference also lies in the error function. So at first, we can use the generalization error x, which means the data is drawn from the actual distribution. However, for the uniform error, the difference is just here, our input is drawn from uniform distribution. And also some research use geometric error, which is the difference between two functions. So here the W star means the function we try to learn, and the W means the function that we learn. So we measure the Euclidean distance between these two.
But somehow, if it is for the model, for deep learning model, so we do not need so complicated, right? So we just need, because the W here is just one dimension. It's just a label or subclass, or it's a confidence score or something like that. So in this case, and this generalization errors, let me think about it, the uniform distribution.
The difference between generalization error and uniform error is just the input, because here we know that the input is drawn from the actual distribution. So that means the input is valid. However, for the uniform error, our new generated input might be invalid.
And there is still an error, right? So it's an error uniform distributions, and f hat is what predictor, right? It would predict it.
So, yeah.
The probability is not equal.
Okay. So yeah, the error function, right? But a lot of research use geometric error.
And it's still, this is still a loss function, right? This error is loss function. Do you see the
The loss function, yeah. So it compute the expectation of that loss function.
Okay, please go on.
So you can see that this active learning process is quite like the model extraction process, because in active learning, the teacher have some knowledge and the student query the teacher with some questions and get the answer, and at last he can learn the knowledge and in our model extraction setting, the server in the cloud have a model, and the adversary can query that model, or not can query that server and get some labeled information, and at last the adversary can learn the model or the function in the server. So basically, this paper links these two scenarios together and implement some experiments. And here I also wanted to mention a paper by this Chermer. So this paper is highly related to this paper. So in the paper written by Chermer, they assume that the server can return label information along with some auxiliary information, for example, like confidence value. They implement some attacks based on this assumption, and they implement attack on different kinds of models like linear SVM, logistic regression, multi-layer perceptrons, which means...
And those SVM models are the model extraction, right? It's more like a model extraction.
What?
So that is, so suppose that the model you want to learn is a deep learning model. And it's still possible that we're using a simpler model to query, to do the model extraction. Is that the case?
I think in Chermer's paper and on the paper I'm presenting today, they assume that when you try to learn the model, you use the same model type.
Okay, so it means that attacker will know what type of model it is, right? So here the point is that, so it's going to do the experiment or do you apply the learnings to extract linear SVM, logistic regression, MLP, etc., right? So some models are easier to extract it while some are not.
Oh, sorry.
I mean, some models are easier to...
Of course.
And I think the decision tree is harder to... Is decision hard to extract?
Because
you have...
It's very different from other models. And at last, they also talks about the scenarios when the server retains only label informations. But if you wanted more details, you can check on this paper.
And I think it's it will be very straightforward to at least challenge to increase the cost of the query-based attack. So we just need to return a categorical label 0 or 1, right?
But it would definitely increase the query complexity. But we still can find a way to extract the model.
Yeah, because the gradient is still there. even if we just return 0 or 1,
you can see it as a passive, you can see it as a passive learning process, right?
No, if we return 0 or 1, it still could be an active learning, because the learner can still send a query to the model.
Mm.
Just as the example you raised.
Yeah,
it can. So fx always returns 0 and 1, but the model, the extracting, so let's say the model to be learned is the target model. Mm. And let's say the learner model and the learning model, because even if the learner model only reply 0 and 1, the learning model can still have a confidence, internal confidence there. So there are always a gradient between the learning model and the learner model, right?
Yeah. So however, in the paper I'm going and present today, here we assume the server only returns level information, and also the adversary have no knowledge of the actual distribution D. Here I also give you a formal definition of a query synthesis scenario. But anyway, the goal is, the goal here is quite clear. So, depending on what kind of targeted model, existing technique can be divided into several categories. So in this paper, they actually do not provide new model extraction technique. Instead, because they link the connection between model extraction and active learning. So when it comes to implementation, they just simply adopt the well-studied active learning technique and do experiment here.
Mm.
Yeah. So So actually, they provide a lot of examples in their paper, and here I just highlighted three. I think is the most important ones. And also, I'm going to go through this algorithm, but if you need to know more details about them, you need to check the specific paper, because I also didn't have the time to go through every algorithms.
Mm.
So here, the first one is a half-space extraction, which means the linear SVM. So we only have, for example, two class. And so this is a linear model. This algorithm is proposed by this author. So the basic idea is, first, you compute the version space V, which is a set of all hypotheses that are consistent with all past queries. That means we already have some queries X and Y. And then, for example, here the function we try to learn is this normal vector W, which is in D dimension. And we find all the W that can meet the requirement of Y times the dot product of W and X, Y is larger than 0.
Let me see. So this is a model, right? So this is a model.
So this is the linear. I think this is the linear.
This is a dot product.
Yeah, dot product.
And the Y I
is the label.
Is a label. Oh, okay. So okay. The point is that, here Y is the label. So that means what the sign of Y I and X I dot W I should always be the same.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. So, they keep all the possible W that can meet this requirement, and the second step that is to measure the volume of V. So in our example, from this equation, we can know that the all possible W is actually the how to the surface of a sphere, because this W is a, we assume it is a normal vector.
Yeah, it is the surface circle, right?
Yeah. So in the second step, you measure the
not a circle, it's a ball, because the dimension is higher than more than ball, right?
Yeah. So you can measure the volume of V, and you can actually check if the volume is below a predefined tolerance. For example, epsilon. If the volume of V is below epsilon, then we can stop. If not, we can they can synthesize a new query that tries to cut the volume of V by one half.
So let's assume that this dimension is this D is equal to. So in this case, the W is more like this space, right?
Yeah.
So in this case, so W will be actually a point on this surface. So the agron is going to how do they synthesize a query?
That
because the W initially, I suppose this is the initial WWI, and how do they generate the query?
I don't know. I just know the high level overview of how this algorithm work. But
I think my question is still a high level question. Cuts the volume and they define the volume of V. Let me interpret. My interpretation may not be correct. You can further evaluation. So you can see for every I here, for this one is a hard constraint, right? That means for every xi, and after we apply W, it will always be the and its sign will always be the sign with yi. So here the volume is more like a loss function. I'm not sure.
I think the volume just means, because here you have a circle, right? And we have some past queries. So at some stage, actually, we have a lot of candidate W that can meet that requirement.
But from the initial stage, we may not find such a W, right? The idea is that how do we find a W prime, which has a faster way to decrease. So let me do the right stuff here. So suppose this is three dimension, right? And suppose these three dimensions, this one is supposed to be function loss error. And this is W1 and W2 here, right? So in this case, we're supposed to be a function here, somehow like this.
I think the volume of V means the number of W. First we have all the W has all possibilities, and then you have some queries, and then from all of the W, there are only, I think, only some of them can meet the requirement of that equation, right? And then you can throw some W away.
Yes, I agree. But the point is, how do we synthesize the query? The query is that cut the volume V by half. So always generate the query. So suppose we have W1.
That means that this new query can there are only half of the W can meet that meet the requirement of that in equation.
Let me think about it. So suppose we randomly generate WiWk. And we would like to now. Somehow get a point. Somehow we would like to synthesize an xi. But we do not know the label. Suppose we would synthesize xi. But this xi is a new xi, right? What we do not know is yi.
Yi is, you can get it by query though.
Yeah, but anyway, we need to do this before the query, right? So we somehow need to select an xi, which by existing model, which can cut the weight by half, and half of them will. Half of them will be gone by this one.
Yeah.
Then we're going to query the real yi, let's say y hat. This is y hat, right? We're using y hat and xi to cut the weight by half. Then we fit the model and to get the real y hat. The real y prime. And then we retrain the model.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm, yeah.
Mm, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, please go on. Mm.
And however, in real world scenarios, the server might flip the outcome before sending it to client. That means this algorithm works in the presence of noisy labels. Let me rephrase my words. So these noisy labels means when the server make a prediction, it do not directly send it to client. It may have a probability of some predefined value to flip the label and then sending it to the client. That means the client might not get the accurate prediction.
But why the server is going to do this?
Because it tries to defend such
a strategy inference on server service, right?
Yeah, so it sacrificed some amount of accuracy in order to defend.
That is stupid. For example, if I'm a rain forecast, the weather forecast, or there's a human face, right? So it will randomly, if the server randomly classify your face as mine, and it will be inference the server.
Yeah, server, but right? But that's the definition of presence of noisy labels.
Mm.
Yeah. So basically, I think their strategy is instead of querying the label for one time, like querying it for example, R times, and then they view the majority vote of the noisy versions as the true outcome.
Sorry, again?
So that means, because if you try to flip.
Okay, so the point that you curate for R times.
Yeah, and then find the majority vote of the outcome.
Yeah, so in this case, it's still not tolerable. It's still not defensive. It's not defensive, right? So suppose we know there is a determinism and the probability of predicting, giving the real label is definitely much larger than that to giving the false label. So in this case, we'll just query for 10 times or 100
yeah,
times.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So like actually, the probability to flip the outcome should be less than 0.5.
Mm.
Otherwise, the model cannot work.
Mm.
Yeah. So actually, this defense strategy is discussed later. But anyway, this algorithm is, I think it's quite important. And also for nonlinear models like kernel SVM extraction, they proposed an extended adaptive training. So the process is first, they initialize a model M with R randomly chosen samples along with the query label. So we randomly generate R samples and then query for their labels. And then we initialize our model M. And at each round, the learner can generate K random samples and compute the outcome, which is FXI. So the F is our our model M?
So let's use the word, the M is a learning model.
Yeah.
The learning model.
So here, for example, at round zero.
And F is our own model. You're still
learning. Which is M.
F is M, right?
So okay. At each round, let's, for example, we add round T. Then this value would be.
So this is very straightforward. So you're always finding the less confident.
It tries to
confirm, right?
It tries to find X that is close to the boundary.
So that's the part. So actually, this is the rationale. For our visualization. So even for the models or so somehow active learning is still very straightforward application for approach. Suppose we are adapting online deep learning model or active learning model. So and our visualizations can be used for debugging and understanding how each active learning strategy work. Suppose our visualization is super accurate.
We just talked about the rationale before.
Please go on.
So here comes the strategy. So there are actually two different strategies. The first one is data independent randomization.
Right.
Yeah. So the rationale of these different strategies is talked about before. So when the server made a prediction and then with a predefined probability, it may flip the outcome and then send it to the client. So here we need to make sure the probability is less than 0.5. And the second strategy is called data dependent randomization. So in this setting, the flipping probability rule needs to depend on data for each instance xi.
Rule is dependent on.
So we will also talk about it, how to implement it later.
Okay, so the point is that why the code, so I still have a little bit first about data dependent. The idea is still generate a false label.
Yes.
And this false label is based on what query I have.
So the difference is in the first setting, the probability is the same for every instance. However, in the second setting, it depends. So in the experiment, we need
So that is a good point here. So this is how the boundary looks like. So suppose giving a random model, a tiny model, let's call a tiny model like MT, right? MT must be have some boundary here. So in this case, suppose we can track a specific client server sessions. So during our session. So giving a sessions, we can somehow suppose there's someone is doing the query attack. We can track its trajectory. So I just come up here. So suppose this trajectory is keeping to the boundary. I'm not sure whether it's correct. So in this case, giving these query strategies here, so that means that something interesting happened here. So by right, the giving samples must be randomized. So it must be randomized here, 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 right? Suppose we observe that in our own model, the giving samples is always keeping close to the boundary. We can somehow infer there's something anomaly happens.
Yeah.
Because this is this one, maybe we can adopt this idea in the future. So the boundary is always a very useful information. So as long as just like someone is asking a very private questions, for example, the model boundary is the most important. I think the model boundary definitely is the most important information of the model. So suppose we are just having a casual conversation. I would say, oh, what's your name? What friends do you have? But however, I would like to ask for your salary. So it's somehow asking, suppose the salary is the most important information you have. So it says, what's your daily expenditure and how much you spend on, how much do you spend on your food or how much you spend on your rental? Mm. And then, so these questions are more, a lot of sensitive questions.
Mm.
So as long as a human, when I send some of the information are close to review the sensitive information, I will still answer it, right? Especially for some ladies. I think the young girls will not mind it, but for the old ladies, mm. So they say that, have you married or do you have a children? And how old is your child? So in this kind of information are still sensitive to the for the ladies' age. So in this case, as long as these stepwise questions will leak information, then we will stop. We will stop answering any of your questions.
Mm.
I think this idea, the boundary exploration, I'm not sure. So you just mentioned that the P is dependent on the data. So this is more like a data poisoning. So have you ever heard about this this approach? It's called data poisoning.
Mm.
Data poisoning is now you are learning me. You are learning my information.
Hmm.
So as long as I want to stop telling the information, I want to give you the false information. So my data, my given data will poison your model. So that's called the data poisoning approach. Hmm. Right. So here I think that's an interesting rationale, and I think these paper presentations leads to some interesting rationale. I'm not sure whether my idea is similar to what you described before, but I think our boundary-based idea somehow will lead to some interesting finding. Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
So I can go on.
Mm, please go on.
And so the first question to answer is active learning useful in settings without any auxiliary information? Mm. I can erase those.
Okay, you can erase
them. Oh, okay.
Mm.
So the model here is also a linear model, and the algorithm used is this algorithm. This algorithm. And here is their results. So yeah, it's quite straightforward. So they successfully implement this attack, and with so if the geometric error is equal to 10 to the power of minus 4, and the cost, it only takes 900 queries to extract the digit data set, the function for digit data set, that is the most complex data set here. Anyway, I think it's quite straightforward. And the second question to answer is active learning useful in scenarios where the oracle is able to perturb the output in a data independent setting? So from the result, A, B, C, D represent a different data set.
How do they do the data independent?
So they just flip the outcome with a predefined probability.
So it is, it's independent, sorry, it's independent.
Oh, independent, yeah, it's independent.
Hmm.
Yeah, so you can see that it just raised the query in complexity, but still they can successfully
reduce the error.
Yeah. And the third question is, active learning useful in scenarios where the oracle is able to perturb the outcome in a data dependent setting? So this experiment also comes from this paper. So how did they flip the outcome with data dependent probability? So first, they learn the mu and covariance of a distribution such that any function drawn from it provides an accurate prediction. So they actually can keep track of a lot of prediction functions.
I'm sorry. So we are talking about the target model, right?
Yeah. So here, because we try to defend.
Yes, we try to defend. So it will collect the distribution of the query. It will collect the distribution of the query. So the
mu- no, the distribution
so
of F.
So what is F?
The F is function, the prediction function.
This is a prediction function of the target model.
Yeah.
And how does the target model make a accurate prediction?
So they not. I think because
how could they know? Because the model there's no ground truth, right? So
you mean how do they know that
this F, function, I'm asking whether this F is a learning model or target model?
The target model.
If it's a target model, how does the target model know it is an accurate prediction?
So here, think of you as a person who tries to defend your model, but the
target model, I do not know whether someone make a prediction. Someone just ask me questions. I'm going to answer it. And he keep his own answer silent, right? Suppose I'm trying to indicate your salary. I don't know your salary. So I will ask the questions and I will have estimation myself.
Mm.
So you give me answer, but you do not know my answer in my mind.
So actually in their setting, they do not consider the X. Actually, they just keep track of some prediction function. And every time someone is query for a label, then they randomly choose a function in the pool and gives them the result.
Randomly choose a function in the pool.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that means the target model have multiple model there.
Yeah. That's what it means. So first they learn the mu and covariance of their function. And then they make sure that any function draw from that distribution
confused. So here, how many target models do we have? For example,
they assume that they learn the distribution of the targeted function. And then every time someone is making a query, they generate a new function from that distribution.
A new function from the distribution.
So here
is the model. Here's the original, we have a model FM, right? And this model works on a distribution D, right? So you mean that from D, we can derive another function FM prime.
Yeah.
And how?
This FM prime can make a prediction. Because this is not a complex scenarios like neural network. In this, in their work, they assumed the F is just like W times.
Okay, linear, it's okay. So
So the W just means, for example, it's a D dimension.
So I'm asking whether M and M prime, the FM and FM prime of the same architecture, of the same type of the model. FM and FM prime of the same model type.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So in, for example, in this, if F equals W times X, then every time you draw from this distribution, you get a new W, which is a D-dimension vector.
So here, the accurate prediction is the consistent prediction with FM.
But remember that.
So how do you define the correct prediction?
How do you define accuracy?
Yeah, we define accuracy based on consistency, right? And suppose this F, as we discussed, come from FM prime, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so FFM prime have a prediction? And how do we know FFM prime have a correct prediction? And what is the ground truth it is select?
For example, the targeted function is F star. And then every time we would draw a new function F, right? Mm. And then the server would return the outcome of
F,
like for example, FX. And this F, the outcome of FX and F star X might be different. That's how they view this as a flip of outcome.
Mm.
So the F and F, the prediction of F and F star might be different.
So once it's different, once it's consistent, once the prediction of F and F star are
consistent, we don't know.
We definitely know, right? We definitely know F star. Because
F star, we know F star. Yeah.
We know F star and we derive a friend. And this is a query, this attacker, right?
Mm. So you just send the outcome of FX to the client.
So I'm asking here the accurate prediction. And how do we know it is accurate prediction? So the accurate prediction is means the consistent prediction between F star and F.
Mm.
Okay. Here is first to learn distribution. Okay, you can keep going on.
Yeah, so in this setting, the client might not get the accurate prediction.
Mm.
But also the adversarial cannot know.
Mm.
And this is their,
Will you please go to the previous slides?
Mm. Sorry.
You clear mine.
Oh, sorry, you need
Yes, I need that thing. So somehow I'm just very curious about the day-dependent settings. And so I've up until now, I haven't learned anything about how the server will flip the labels giving the instance.
Let me draw the picture again. So at first we have F star, and every time we would generate a new F, and this is the client. And this is the query for X, and the server would return a F, the prediction of FX, right?
Mm.
So I think this is not the data dependent that you understand in our previous discussion. So here, how they did it is every time they generate a new F, the prediction of F and F star, if they are the same, we do not know if they are the same. So that's how they, so they thought of it as flipping the sign. Because this FX is random.
And the point is that
they do not consider X, the input X. They just randomly choose AF.
But so in this case, why is it called data dependent setting?
The paper say they view this process as a data dependent, but actually
And how this W star comes?
W star just means F star, means that function.
The original model, the time model?
Yeah.
And how do we calculate the role?
So for example, they do 1,000 experiment and see calculate how many times the prediction of F star and F is the same. So the probability is not predefined because we every time we randomly generate a new F. So this, so every time the probability is not.
Okay, so I think we should call it an end for this discussion. Mm. And so the other people, the students may not be interested. So, but I suggest that after today you have a, maybe you have a further detailed discussions about data dependent, what is data dependent settings. I think we, I understand you may get the majority of the part, but I, based on your explanation, I feel that still some part you might missing, so some part may still a little bit confused. So I think Mike,
No, this is their approach. They do not consider the input X, even though they say it is a data dependent, but their approach they just randomly generate F.
Yeah, so that means it's just spend time to generate a new F. So this so it still means that it says generate, it actually means train, right? You actually need to train a new F.
Mm.
Which is share a similar behaviors with F star.
Yeah.
And then it will send an F using the result of F instead of F star.
Mm.
And suppose F and F star are actually equivalent. So I don't know how F will be different from F star. Of course, you will have different initialization or different randomizations. So it seems that, well, the F used, F will never be, so after we train F star, F star will never be used anymore, unless it is, right?
Yeah.
But unless they used the reference. So unless we can see the consistency between F and F star. So in giving the role, so suppose if we have a probability of an accurate prediction, that means we will need to train F1, F2, and to Fn, right? So they will derive a set of F and to see how many, and going to see the consistency between F star and F.
Mm.
Then we have a probability. Then we can calculate the probability.
Yes. So this is how they do the experiment. You can see the next slide.
So the basic idea of defend active learning or curie-based attack is that we cannot compromise. We definitely cannot compromise the service. We need a way to defend the query. We need to detect when it is doing a curie-based attack and just stop it without compromise our service, the service performance or the accuracy of the service. So I just feel that this flipping idea, I'm a little bit troubled.
I'm very confused when I read that part, but this is how they present their idea. So okay. Yeah, so you can see the result. So the x-axis is separation parameter C. The C just means how close the new generate F to our F star. Can you get my yuck?
So how to read this paper?
Hmm?
So they have three model, and what is the relation with adult income, breast cancer, and a mushroom?
There are three different data set.
Okay, there are three different data set.
Yeah, so and the separation parameter C means how close the new generated F and our F star is.
So why is there the 10 to 10? The huge, well, so that is no difference, but the huge difference. And how come the C will be, it's okay to understand it's 0.01.
Mm.
And I still kind of confused about this huge odd number. So it's more like a.
But anyway, and then for us, and then they generate, and then the probability means they generate 1,000 new function F, and the probability that the FX is equal to F star X.
Maybe you can pause these slides. I think unless there's maybe there's a misunderstanding, there might be a misunderstanding. So yeah, I think we passed this because we're
okay.
Yeah.
And then they also prove that passive learning is useful in scenarios of data-dependent defense. But this data-dependent also means what we talked about before. And this is their result. So they show that the passive learning is, and the passive learning, they use the state-of-the-art algorithm. Yeah. And also they show that QS active learning is useful to extract nonlinear model, but the outcome can the outcome it should looks really good because they also use the some of the state of the art algorithm in the active learning area. Yeah. So basically, that's all.
Okay, I think, Xiaoling, the first point I want to say is that this presentation is much better than your past presentation. You did a very good job for elaborating those ideas. And during this presentation, I still have a new idea to better defend a query-based attack, but I just feel that you do not have much time to work on that. So the visualization and the cross projects are the first one to do, but of course we can leave these ideas. So at least we have some new ideas. Yeah, so once someone have their hands on, we can let them choose.
We can definitely do that in the future.
Okay, so in this case, I think both Ruofan and Xiaoling did a very good job to present it. And these meetings are actually taking longer than expected because there's still confusion there. And thanks everyone to attend it. And in the future, I think we'll further compress the time of a progress report. And I think for this progress report, we spent more time to illustrating Xiaoling's boundary definition, right? So in this case, Xiaoling, you may spend more time on the boundary definitions. In this case, you still explore it. And we discuss this on next Thursdays. And in the meantime, I think, of course, Xue Zhi, Zhengfeng, and Zhang Chen will have the individual task. And yeah, it's good. It's good that we have this fruit for discussions. And let's call it a day. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks.